Why I call this story The Sun is for Free. Coppet Crest is since 1987 producing microgreens. It started very small. And in 2000, I joined the company. In 2002, I took it over. And there were a few things for me which were very critical. One of them all is, of course, taste. I want to have taste. I'm selling taste. I supply about 70,000 restaurants per week in Europe. And they buy my stuff because they want taste. So taste me is number one. Then it comes to sustainability. I know my product is shipped long distance. And I know the patron made a point about it, that vegetables are shipped 2,000 kilometers. Yes and no. Shipping by trailer is not that expensive and not that polluting. I mean, we all use the American examples. But in Europe, a circle of 800 kilometers is still a domestic market. But I said, okay, I want to make sure that nobody can say I'm polluting. So I focused on cost of energy. And Holland gives the system of the greenhouse as energy source. I mean, you can imagine if the sun is shining on the greenhouse, it's getting extremely hot. And if you don't open your windows, it will be too hot to grow. In my greenhouse, we still keep the windows closed and we harvest the heat by heat exchangers. We store it underground in aquifers and I don't have fossil fuel. I heat my greenhouse with all electric. I also use the heat from canals next to me. I use the heat from a sun collector with water, which has a 50% efficiency, so it's very high. And we will be on geothermal very soon. So then we have, in fact, energy plus more than we need. To give an idea, with my 100,000 square meters I'm running, my electricity cost is 3% of my turnover. And if I see that on the vertical farming, I see very high prices. A very important thing for me is also food safety. So I want to be able to see my product, to be close to the product and check it intensively. And I think we all agree that lamps are very expensive heaters. Many vertical farms have to be cooled because the lamps produce too much heat. So I had a vertical farm in 2008 because I could not, 2006 actually, I couldn't buy my neighbors. I was growing about 20% per year. To give an idea, in 2002, when I purchased the company, turnover was 2 million. And this year, let's say last year, we had a turnover of 38 million. And this year, we have a minor dip. There was something with restaurants. I don't know if you noticed it in the newspapers, but there was something. So, but the good news is we are back on 80% weekly turnover. So the restaurants are again buying us. What we're missing now is catering. Airlines, the business class, and the cruise ships, but that's the only thing. Lamps are very expensive. I had a multi-layer trial in 2008, and what I wanted was to make sure I didn't get too much heat in the layers. So I asked that moment the supplier. I made an agreement with Lemnis to make lamps which were water cooled. And the water cooling is still a system Lemnis uses, and it's fantastic because those lamps we have now high in the greenhouse or anywhere provide still so much heat, although they are LEDs, that you're wasting the energy. It all goes into the air or it goes out or you have to cool it. Now, this is an old picture. This is my, so you can see, I also know about multi-layer. This is my storage. This is the cooling down of my product for one night. So I know multi-layer, and I know very well that if I put lamps in between, I can grow. But I can't see it. When you see my greenhouse like this, this is only one crop. This is shiso purple, and we supply, we roughly sell one row per day to the restaurants. I can see from this angle, I can see my whole greenhouse. And I always get very nervous when I have a multi-layer farm. And I've been to 20 or 30, most in Japan. But you can't see the product. You can't talk to the product. You cannot read the product. And yes, you can have all kinds of computers and drones and tests and other equipment. I'm a grower. My people are growers. Yes, we have a lot of techniques and high-end with sensors and things and so on. But I, when I walk around the farm once a day, I want to see the crop. So I like vertical farming, but I'm mainly on one layer. You have to visualize, and I have 80 different plant types, varieties, so it's also very complicated. We have about three different types of lamps. I still have all Son-T because they still work, and I invested in it, and so I keep them. I have two different types of LED, and the LED is made for a certain group of products. So the lamps are made for us. It's our assortment because we made the lamps. We made the recipe of the lamp. We made ourselves. And the good thing for us is when you work with microgreens, you can do a test in 3 weeks. You know exactly in 3 weeks where you are, where you see all the very complicated trials on tomatoes. That takes a year. So that's why we were so quick with the LED and fully in production in 2009. The cost of this row multi-layer, let's say 5 layers, would be 1 million euro. Then I can do 5 rows in one layer. If I do 3 of these rows, I can more or less do 1 hectare. 4 rows. If I have 4 rows, I have 1 hectare condensed to multi-layer. That is 4 million euro. I can't see the product, and for 4 million euro, I can build a fantastic greenhouse again, which is providing its own energy. So, yes, I have multi-layer things. The machine Petra showed, the vertical box, we have installed on the Holland America line, the cruise ships. They produce every day fresh microgreens on board, and we remotely control it from Holland, from our computer. Does it work? No, because a chef is not a grower. And even if you have the good recipes, he forgets to filter, to put the fertilizer in, whatever you do, he goes wrong. So it's not really working. I love the idea of urban farming. I promote that every child should have his own kindergarten growing to have his first vegetable self-grown. But why am I based in the Westland? I'm based next to the biggest distribution system of vegetables in Europe. This vegetable hub is next to my doorstep. The logistics is not the most expensive part on the sustainability. Yes, it's for America. I know that vertical farming in America is a big thing in talking. When they talk about vertical farming, they talk about tomatoes, for instance. And I recall that the television was made by Ted van Heining, one of the best growers in the world on tomatoes. And he said, why don't you grow vertical farming on tomatoes? And he was not smart enough to say at that moment, look, I grow my tomatoes vertical. For Americans, tomato growing is flat cultivation on the ground, California, cheap labor, harvesting from the ground. If you would call our greenhouses plant factories, that's the word, the Japanese term for what we're doing, this is a plant factory. I can close it. I can do all kinds of things with it. I can harvest the heat. If you see these white blocks in between, these are the heat collectors. They harvest the heat. They take the heat out. They put cold air under the ground, and the hot water is stored for the winter. So I heat my greenhouse with the summer of the year before. That's a plant factory. So the efficiency is the most important thing for me. Efficiency on energy, the way of looking, the way of growing. And yes, after 33 years of growing, we have a very good recipe. We know how long, when the product is going to be ready. We don't need very complicated computers about it. We do it maybe in a small handbook. So I'm not saying that vertical farming is nothing, but I get jealous on the attention it gets when I saw a vertical farming farmer talking about growing wheat. Wheat brings a bloody 11 cents a kilogram. Why grow wheat on a vertical farm? Come on. America is so much focused on vertical farming. It's the only country with so much land that you don't know how to use it. They think per square mile. They don't even think per square meter. So I don't get it. Growing next to cities, yes, I understand. That's why the Westland has developed so well. It's in the Randstad. It's very close to The Hague, Rotterdam, Delft. It's nearby cities. It's transport-wise, in a circle of 800 kilometers, it has the big metropole of Europe. Growing in Shanghai, yes, I understand. I worked in Shanghai 20 years ago, and I said, guys, you have to keep your greenhouses over here because you sell everything for building. You have no food. Now Shanghai has to import all this food from 200 kilometers. Should they go to vertical farming? Fine. If they want to burn money, do it. But be smart on growing. Make hundreds hectares of intensive cultivation in plant factories, 1,000 hectares. Do it well organized, do it central, and you're far more efficient than all these vertical farms. This is a nice picture, always people like it because it's at the twilight zone, so it's in the evening, and you see the color green coming through, and it amazes everybody. It's a beautiful, beautiful picture. I stole this picture from National Geographic. It's beautiful. It's illegal because I normally have to close down the window, so the curtain. So I kept it open for National Geographic, and I got 25 phone calls from my neighbors saying, "Hey, what the fuck are you doing? Because this light is very intensive." Yeah, what can I say more about it? I made some notes about it. The urban cropping I did, yes, sustainability. I think I'm very sustainable. I even got an award of being the most sustainable grower in the Netherlands. The vegetables shipping 2,000 kilometers is not really necessary. And when it's necessary, you have to calculate the difference in cost of heating or transporting from a sun-blessed area. And towards Steven about no pesticides, I haven't used pesticides for the last 20 years on my farm. So that's not an issue. And when you talk about we have to sell to the retail, keep in mind that the retail will never pay for expensive products from vertical farms. They are so much price driven that even if there's €2 labor cost difference in Belgium and Netherlands, then Belgium is supplying and not Netherlands. So be very careful. And again, technology-wise, a lot is possible. It's fun to do. But please, if you have to invest your money, be very, very careful. And take remote areas. Think about the Middle East. Think about South Pole. Think about North Russia. But any other place in the world where you still have sunlight, I would stick to sunlight. Thank you.